Hello everyone, this is Taboo Conspiracy, and if you're new to the Flat Earth, welcome to the first and most important grassroots scientific movement in recorded history. This is round 2 of 10 of Flat Earth Fundamentals, and today we're going to discuss the professionals who support a flat and stationary Earth. In round 1, we discussed the fact that there's absolutely no detectable and measurable curvature, and there should be. I provided many examples from various individuals to demonstrate the total lack of curvature from the ocean surface all the way up to 121,000 feet, and I believe we flat earthers have made a very convincing case. If the curvature of the Earth existed, it would be tested and discussed in every classroom. Children would learn how the adjacent city just 60 miles away would be hidden by 2,400 feet of the Earth's curvature, and would conduct experiments to prove the same. Instead, no one, not in astronomy, geography, engineering, construction, or even surveying courses, have ever learned to calculate the curvature by simply just squaring the distance in miles and multiplying by 8 inches. It's simple. Although the curvature formula is easy to understand, highly accurate with invisible distances, and could be tested by every student, it's ignored by all institutions. Do you not see that the curvature isn't discussed because there is no curvature? But when I first began my Flat Earth investigation, I tried to come up with reasons as to why the curvature of the Earth wasn't manifest with high zoom cameras or weather balloon footage. You probably have considered the same. Was there some sort of physics that was causing the alleged ball whirl to appear flat to optical observation? We already discussed refraction in the round 1 video and showed that refraction doesn't cause objects over the horizon to somehow bend in an arc over a curvature, but that refraction only obscures and distorts the flat horizon. Despite the lies of the naysayers, just imagine how complex it would be for refraction to consistently, and as the standard, to cause all images to bend in a perfect arc over a ball to trick us into seeing a flat world. If refraction has this magical property of flattening the ball, then you would have to say that generally nothing disappears behind the curvature because refraction always produces a flat world. But doesn't it seem highly convenient that there was a debate of ball versus flat Earth for millennia, and now when we have the ability to zoom in and test it with cool cameras and share it with the world, and we can prove that the boat has not disappeared behind the curvature, and the response now changes to, well, refraction makes it so boat images arc over the horizon and always flattens the exponential slope of the curvature, whether you're on a mountain or at the ocean. Now, doesn't that sound like a contrived excuse to you to explain away reality? But could there be some other optical effect causing this flat Earth phenomenon? It was clear to me refraction alone was insufficient, but I thought maybe gravity combined with refraction could possibly curve space and time to create a flat Earth, or even some other undiscovered physics that is causing the world to strangely present itself as flat to telescopic measurements and weather balloon footage. Honestly, it seemed as though I was grasping at straws to maintain my comfortable paradigm, much like Einstein's theory of relativity, but flat Earth still seemed even more impossible to me at that time. So, my line of thinking brought me to the professionals, who would necessarily have to deal with the curvature on a frequent basis. Maybe our eyes could be somehow tricked into believing the Earth is flat, but the same physics would not apply to a surveyor or a pilot who would be required to make substantial physical, not optical, adjustments for the curvature. Well, it turns out the pilots never account for the curvature or the purported 1,000 mile per hour spinning atmosphere, and nothing in their equipment makes such automatic adjustments. Surveyors, now I'm talking about the real plane surveyors, not the fake geodetic surveyors, who are never actually used in the surveying practice, but we'll talk about that later. But the real everyday surveyors never account for the curvature, and never even learned about the curvature other than someone else or something else accounts for it. At small distances, for example, a home, this wouldn't be an issue. But there are roads, railways, canals, pipe and electrical lines, bridges, tunnels, etc. that run for many miles. But even at only 1 mile, 6 inches of curvature should be accounted for. Surveyors would want to know about those 6 inches. But at 10 miles? 66 feet of curvature would have to be accounted for. At 100 miles, a shocking 6,667 feet, that is, over 1 1/4 miles, must be accounted for. I think you get the point.
The longest bridge in the world in China is 102.4 miles long, and at that distance, we should see nearly a 7,000-foot drop in curvature, but we don't, proving that the Earth is flat.
Going back to a distance of merely 10 miles, that's a curvature drop equal to the height of a 6-story building. Look at this picture. Do you really think an engineer would not be concerned with curvature this high at just 10 miles distance when designing a road or drawing plans for a pipeline? Think about it. Over flat terrain, these construction connections generally occur at 90-degree angles. Eventually, some curvature would have to be accounted for. Materials, excavation, and architectural designs would depend highly on curvature calculations. Surveyors pride themselves in accounting for every inch, but never learned about the huge adjustments for curvature necessary on large projects? That's just impossible. Often, you will hear someone claim that curvature is considered in big projects. For example, watch this silly statement from YouTuber named Vsauce and the great reply by Flat Earth Asshole.
It might seem flat over short distances, but over longer ones, well, the Earth is pretty darn curvy. The Verrazano Narrows Bridge connecting Staten Island and Brooklyn had to be designed with Earth's roundness in mind. Its two towers, separated by 1,300 meters and perfectly vertical, are nonetheless 41 millimeters further apart at the top than at the bottom because of Earth's curvature.
The argument is not whether the bridge is curved, the argument is whether the Earth is curved. We can indeed build a bridge with curvature. However, the water underneath the bridge will naturally fine and maintain its level. If we were to draw a straight line from one side of the bridge to the other, we can clearly see that the water underneath the bridge is 100% flat and level. However, the bridge is indeed curved. This just proves you can build a bridge with curvature, but the water underneath the bridge is indeed 100% flat.
In this round two video, we're going to hear from various professionals, including pilots, engineers, surveyors, a tank gunner, an artilleryman, a Navy missile operator, a radar operator, an Air Force navigator, and even a submarine chief, all who will say that they never accounted for or witnessed the curvature of the Earth or its alleged axial spin during their entire careers. With all of the subsequent videos, I will be taking out relevant excerpts to try to keep the segments under 5 minutes each, but it's still going to be a long video. I will give links to all the videos in the comments section, but I want to especially thank Mark Sargent and his Subject Matter Expert series. Mark Sargent's Flat Earth Clues series is also a good introduction in the Flat Earth, and I'll try to have a link to that in the description. If the Earth were a sphere, aircraft flights would have to constantly correct their altitudes by dipping their nose downward to account for the curvature of the Earth. At a normal cruising speed of 500 miles per hour, the commercial airline pilot would have to repeatedly dip the nose of the plane downwards and descend approximately 4,628 feet in just 10 minutes of flying, or 7.9 miles in 30 minutes of level flying. Clearly, pilots never perform this action. Gravity doesn't solve this problem. First, do you really think that gravity could just happen to have the ability to enable an aircraft to generally maintain perfect elevation? Why would gravity do that? Second, even if gravity had the supernatural ability to cause the entire airplane to maintain perfect elevation, gravity would also have to pull the nose downward more than the rest of the plane. In other words, even if gravity could somehow keep the plane at the same altitude around a spinning ball, the nose of the plane would eventually be pointing towards space unless gravity pulled it down more than just the center of the airplane's mass. How do we know that aircraft don't have advanced instruments that compensate for curvature? The answer is because the lack of curvature can be tested yourself. Get on a small airplane without the advanced equipment and level it out in the air and pay no attention to the horizon as you just maintain the exact same angle of flight at 200 miles per hour. After only 10 minutes of level flying, if the spherical model were correct, you'd have to make a correction of approximately 726 feet to return to the same altitude. Instead, you'll generally remain perfectly parallel with the ground. Now watch this video of the Blue Angels. It's amazing to watch the acrobats these pilots engage in at tremendous speeds, speeds as high as 720 miles per hour. But do you really think that these pilots are considering curvature corrections during these maneuvers? The Blue Angels pride themselves in maintaining their distances as low as 18 inches between the airplanes. Imagine how difficult that would be at 720 miles per hour.
Alright, here we go.
I think it's clear. Pilots do not make adjustments for the curvature, and gravitational attraction cannot act as some sort of magical leveling device for airplanes. It's absurd. But since I'm on this video, I'm going to make a slight tangent, as I think this is absolutely hilarious. Now see if you can see the difference between the very experienced Blue Angels pilots in their FA-18 Hornets with 11,000 pounds of thrust, flying under 720 miles per hour, and our so-called astronauts in space rockets with more than 930,000 pounds of thrust, traveling at speeds higher than 4,700 miles per hour.
Speed and liftoff. Shane Kimbrough, Sergei Ryzhikov, and Andrei Borisenko blasting off from Kazakhstan, making their way towards the International Space Station. The first stage of the Soyuz delivering 930,000 pounds of thrust from those four strap-on boosters and single-core engine. Liftoff of Tim Kopra, Yuri Malenchenko, and Timothy Peake on their way to the International Space Station. So far, getting good first stage performance. The Soyuz delivering 930,000 pounds of thrust. You can see British astronaut Tim Peake there, over in the right seat, in the center, Soyuz commander Yuri Malenchenko. Everything going well for the Soyuz craft as it continues its climb. The Soyuz already traveling at a speed of over 4,700 miles an hour.
This one, we're going next one here at 5. Oh, all right, here comes the pod, we'll get after it.
I don't care what Wikipedia quote you have, these astronauts are not blasting into space at insane speeds without experiencing substantial acceleration forces. Instead, the astronauts don't even look like they're even on a kid's merry-go-round. But, getting back on topic, the following older video is from SAR-27, who establishes the fact that the curvature math is correct, that pilots training below radar, flying at about 100 feet off the surface for 30 minutes, would have to make substantial corrections to maintain a level flight. I like this video, as it was the first time I saw the curvature math proven through AutoCAD, a highly accurate engineering drafting software.
And from what you see there is that the plane is actually about a good 30 to 40 feet off of the ground, because the dimensions of the Super Hornet is about 60 feet in length. Now, to do the below radar training on the sea or on land, they actually fly about 100 feet or maybe a little lower, and they do it continuously to go over the surface of the land or the water. And in order to do that, they do it for very many miles. I mean, they can go upwards from 50 miles to 200 miles. And the actual test that I want to show you is that how these military jets don't compensate for the curvature is the fact that they actually do this for about an hour or 30 minutes, and they do this with training on land or sea. And right here I have the test that they can do, or anybody can do really, but this math is pretty simple. The military aircraft with no autopilot is usually how it's done, and it's for about 30 minutes above the ocean's surface at 100 foot altitude for 30 minutes at 400 miles an hour. Now at 400 miles an hour, that's 60 minutes. That's going to be 6.66 miles per minute. Now 30 minutes at 6.66 miles per minute is about 199.8 miles traveled in a straight line, and they do not curve down for any curvature. Now the pilot would have, if the ball is actually, you know, like the Earth's radius at 3,959 miles, the pilot would have traveled 199.8 miles with about 319,000 inches of curvature below them in just 30 minutes if they didn't nose down for the curve. Now, we all know that water is always level, and the planes actually go against free fall acceleration, so they're able to go against the free fall acceleration and do what they want. Now, when they're traveling in this straight line in 30 minutes at those inches, when you convert them by 12, that's 26,613 feet, or you can convert that to miles, that's going to be 5.05 miles above the ocean. And I want to show that also again with AutoCAD. I'm going to make a circle. Of 3959 miles. Zoom out because it's pretty big. And again, this is AutoCAD and uses 15 digit precision. It's AutoCAD Civil 2016. If you're not familiar with this program, it's an architectural program. It's very precise and it is the best, and it's the best for quite a few reasons. I'm gonna take a linear dimension of the curvature drop. And if you see there, it comes out to about 5.074 miles. And I'll do another dimension here for the distance, so you can all see that in fact it is 200 miles. Now, remember that I rounded this up to 200 miles, and the diagram that I made was at 199.8, but it's just about the same, 5.04, and this one is at 5.07. Now, anyone can put this to the test. The math is correct.
The next clip is Bob from Globebusters. Globebusters is awesome, so be sure to subscribe. Like others we'll hear from, Bob is a pilot and an engineer and knows his equipment well. He goes into depth describing the unbelievable adjustments for curvature that would be necessary to maintain level flight. In just 8 minutes, a plane at standard speed would need to correct for 400 feet, and a pilot would know that these corrections were being made. Although gyroscopes constitute one of my subsequent key proofs of the flat Earth, Bob also explains why gyroscopes prove the Earth is flat.
The first thing I want to point out is that I took this airline speed of 518.75 miles per hour, right? And in 1 minute, it has traveled 8.6458 miles, okay? Curvature, Z-axis in feet is 49.83 feet. Average foot per minute drop, 49.836 feet, right? Makes sense.
That's the same that I got.
Yep, absolutely. So now, just for fun, I took it and I did it at the double the speed, supersonic, and it's interesting because you're going faster and you're covering more of the curvature. You've gone now 17 miles, 17.29, which is exactly double the distance traveled. Makes sense, okay. But the curvature, because of the fact that it is an exponential function because it falls off faster the further you go out, has now dropped to 199 foot per minute. Now, obviously, we're talking about an airliner here, so this is kind of moot, but I just wanted to throw it in there just for, you know, just for funsies, okay? Now, at 2 minutes, we have gone the same as the double the speed on the 1 minute, 17.2917. The curvature feet and z-axis, of course, remains the same, but because of the fact that we're doing it in 2 minutes instead of one, the average foot per minute drops to 99.672. So then I started kicking it up, and you know, I originally was doing this in like 15-minute increments and then dividing it down, but then I said, oh, hey, wait a minute, Wolfie's doing it 1 degree every 8 minutes, so let's see what happens in 8 minutes if you do not compensate for this curvature. Okay, and I'm saying if you do not compensate for this curvature, right? Well, according to Wolfie, if you don't touch that thing, you just let it fly off, then in that 8 minutes, you've traveled 69 miles, and the Earth has fallen out from underneath you at 3,189 feet, okay, giving you a average foot per minute of 398.6690 feet in that 8 minutes. Now, I got to tell you guys, when you're dropping at 400 foot a minute, that's akin to a pretty healthy glide approach to the airport. You know, that's probably something like what they would do starting their descent into a city. And it takes several, you know, it takes a long, long time. You know, sometimes they'll start their descent half hour out, 45 minutes out, whatever. I was going to say, so in other words, if a pilot is getting a little lackadaisical and, he doesn't make any compensation for a few minutes, well, all of a sudden now he's dropping at a few hundred feet per minute. And like I said earlier, once you set your trim rate, you can go for a half an hour without ever having so much as plus or minus 50 foot in altitude change. So, you know, again, what we're debunking here is the idea that the pilot or the autopilot, either one, has to physically make changes. So why don't we just apply Occam's razor to this and say, what's the simplest explanation? That the Earth is curved and gravity and all these things are actually compensating and adjusting the orientation, or that the pilot is making adjustments that would be tantamount to very large vertical course corrections, whether it's done in small blocks of time or great blocks of time. Of course, that is completely blown away by the fact that, you know as well as I do, when you trim that aircraft out, you can fly for hundreds of miles without ever having to make any correction whatsoever. Now, of course, your response to that would be something like, oh, well, you just got lucky and hit that trim, so it's perfectly making the adjustment for you, which, of course, I'm saying, come on, let's get real here. All right, that's not what's happening at all. So how do we break this stalemate? I mean, well, first of all, if we don't solve it via Occam's razor, you know, and take the simplest explanation, which of course would be the flat Earth, and of course I have a lot of, I'm watching the chat and I'm seeing a lot of people say, oh, are you saying gravity doesn't exist? Yes, we are. We're saying it doesn't exist in the way that you guys have been taught that it exists. And if you want to go back and look at not only my explanation of what gravity actually is, but some of the other physicists going all the way back to Tesla and understanding that the notion of what we're calling gravity is actually an electrostatic force that is provable and demonstrable that's being generated from the plane Earth itself. Well, there's your gravity, okay? But so Occam's razor aside, even if we don't choose to take Occam's razor and we want to accept that gravity is doing all these measurements, what's going to be the stalemate? What's going to be the tiebreaker here? Well, the answer to that, Wolfie, is the gyroscope, all right? It's a gyro. Gyros stay rigid in space. they, not all aircraft have Schuler tuning mechanisms, and the pendulous vanes is not a legitimate argument for saying that that is what's compensating for the correction of the gyroscope. Because if it was, Wolfie, then we wouldn't need a Schuler tuning mechanism now, would we? Okay, so let's just kind of eliminate that there. And what we're going to prove with our pilots is we're going to put an independent gyro in an airplane, and we're going to go flying straight and level, and we're going to see if there is any precession in that gyro. Now, we already know that the gyros don't precess on the ground, even though Leon Foucault said that it did in his 170-year-old gyroscope. Leon Foucault was a liar. So what is the tiebreaker? The gyroscope. The gyroscope proves unequivocally that there is no rotation to the Earth and there is no curvature to the Earth, because I got news for you. Your gyros, after 12 hours of flight, are going to show a 90 degrees orientation shift when you get done taking your little plane flight. It doesn't have to, you don't have to go all the way around the plane. 90 degrees is more than enough. 45 is more than enough. Actually, a lot less than that is more than enough, because zero is zero is zero. If there is no precession after 5 minutes, and no precession after a half an hour, and no precession after an hour, then there's not going to be any precession after 12 hours. It's as simple as that.
The next videos are from Mark Sargent's expert series. In the first video, Mark interviewed a commercial surveyor who had a 32-year career and surveyed large projects. The experienced surveyor affirmed that the curvature of the Earth was never considered or discussed, but should have been an integral part of his and others' surveying work. In the next video, Mark interviewed a 27-year USDA surveyor who affirmed the same and added that the whole idea of sea level does not work on a globe.
I got an interesting call from a surveyor, and by that I mean a land surveyor, commercial land surveyor specifically. He doesn't shoot the line of sight on homes or anything. He does commercials, commercial property, big things like car factories, airport runways, stadiums, that sort of stuff, big tracts of land. He's basically going to say when he comes out here that he did his entire career in the Midwest, started in Indiana. And he did big tracts of land. And he's basically saying, look, the whole industry of being a commercial surveyor, everything is based on a plane. It's based on a flat model. They say when you shoot your lines and you lay out the land for the construction teams, you're basically working on a flat plane. And I thought that was intriguing. And this guy was saying that here's the problem. And he actually asked this when he was younger. And apparently this has just been passed down from generation to generation of surveyors, where they say when somebody asks, well, what about we deal with the curvature? And they go, and the saying is, oh, just don't worry about it, because you're working on a flat plane, right? The project you're working on is a flat plane. Well, the problem is everybody is working on a flat plane. What they're saying is every surveyor that goes out builds his model like the ground is perfectly flat. You're like you're working on a flat chessboard. But the problem is that you're working on your chessboard and you have to interlock with somebody else that's working on another project next to you. And he's working on a flat chessboard. The problem is eventually those chessboards have to butt up against each other. And the curvature has to come into play at some point, and it never does. It just everything interlocks perfectly like Legos. And you know, in a city. So he's going, it doesn't seem like much when you're just working from one piece of property to another, but think about an entire length of city. You know, a city from beginning to end. You can't tell me there's no curve from going, you know, there's not going to be a conflict from one end of the city to the other end of the city. There's going to be feet of curve that nobody takes into account. They don't even talk about it. So you were a surveyor in the United States from 1979 until you retired in?
11. Well, 30 years. Yeah.
So 2009, roughly?
Well, 11.
Oh, 2011. So 32 years.
Uh-huh.
Got it. So surveying, you know, United States, and you specialized in large construction surveying, not houses or anything like that. Manufacturing plants.
Sports stadiums, Eli Lilly projects, big turbines, big buildings, Toyota, you know, mile-long car plant, Federal Express, the tarmacs at the airport. I mean, it would have been a daily joke. Oh, curvature of the earth. Oh, made a mistake. Curvature of the earth. Oh, we don't match each other. We don't match each other because you came off of that point and I came off of this point, and there's curvature in between. It would have happened every day.
Got it. So let's kind of delve into that a little bit, because you and I were talking about this off air, which was when it comes to point to point. So like you're working on a project and somebody else is working on another part of the project, but you everything that you've told me so far, and we'll get into it, is that surveyors work on a flat plane model.
It's called a plane survey.
A plane survey. That is your technical term for it. And so if you're working on your plane survey and another guy is working on his plane survey, well, there's a problem there if you guys end up meeting each other, because technically there should be a curve in if you believe that that everything's curved, there should be a curve in between you two. Therefore, where your edges match up, there should be a conflict, right?
Well, exactly. And the USPS markers don't give you any limitations on how far you can project that plane.
Do you know anybody off the top of your head that actually, because remember, you're working on a planar model. Did you ever talk to anybody in your career that was actually using the geodetic model as on their project?
No.
From one city to the next, you've got a whole bunch of different surveyors working on different plane models, and these models have to link up. And where they link up, unfortunately, the distance between one end to the of a city to another, there should be a little bit of a curve there. And that means the models won't match up. It's like fitting two pieces of tile together, but you've got different tile workers on, you know, working on it.
Yeah. And they're different shapes.
And they're different shapes on top of it. They're not even like you're matching up a square to a square.
You don't even take into consideration curvature, and everything always works.
The surveying books basically say, you know what, you're just going to be working off a flat model. Don't worry about anything outside of your flat model because you don't know what's outside there. But everybody else that's doing their same thing, they're reading the same thing. So, okay, my flat model is hooking up to your flat model, which is hooking up to your flat model, which means it'll all work out just fine.
It does.
So the curvature is more or less just ignored because no one's ever seen it. So the textbooks say, yeah, don't worry about it. It's nothing to sweat, right?
Well, right.
Because you're working on your project and you've got, you know, your friends working on their projects, but when they connect, they work, nobody questions it because it works. It's like, oh yeah, well, everything looks good. Let's just keep doing what we're doing. Nobody ever questions the curvature of the earth. It's never, in fact, in the 32 years that you were doing surveying, you guys never, when you're sitting over coffee, never came up.
No.
I called you because I, as a retired USDA employee, I ran across your documentary Flat Earth Clues.
Yeah.
And now about 30 minutes into it, as a career surveyor in my career, that I realized that you were bringing something forward that I knew was true, and I was humbled, somewhat ashamed of myself for it never crossing my mind in all the years that I was surveying things on a level.
Nice.
And that's why we're here, why I'm here. But what we did, we were a technical agency that surveyed and designed conservation practices, namely on independent landowners, namely farmers, mm-hmm. and the government, and the state government as well. We had cost share programs, and many of these things that we designed and built were partially paid for by the state or federal government. We had the technical authority to design them, to certify them as completed. But some of the jobs, and we had other departments, one in particular was a watershed department, where we had a program to reduce flooding. Mm-hmm. And we build larger scope practices and projects, namely dams. And any dam that would impound 5 acres or more of permanent pool area, in layman's terms, that would be approximately 5 football fields with the end zones taken off.
Sure.
Or any dam that has a pool area that's 25 feet deep or greater.
Mm-hmm.
Those surveys, those jobs, the attitude of the employees went from trying to be speedy and efficient to very thorough and accurate. And those, when I watched your documentary, I thought of those jobs because those jobs had to be surveyed and tied to elevation above sea level.
Got it. Got it. So can you elaborate a little bit more on here? So for those people who don't know, first of all, the USDA stands for?
United States Department of Agriculture.
Perfect. And you imagine in 27 years, you probably started shooting, you know, doing the legwork, walking out in the field and shooting land parcels?
From day one.
That's what you went. And, you know, with a spotting scope? What do you call those when you're surveying?
We call them instruments. They eventually got laser instruments later in my career, but I always liked using just a survey instrument, a level, on a tripod, and we had someone, a technician, that would hold the rod, and we would survey whatever area where you're planning on constructing something, come back, and we plot it out like on an AutoCAD, and then we do the hydrology based on storm frequencies, determine the geometric shape of what we're building, and provided oversight during construction, checking compaction, and when they were done, we would survey it again and certify that it met specs, and these larger jobs were also met and tied to elevation above sea level.
Well, you mentioned the thing that intrigued me was you said, hey, you know, there's something you guys really haven't talked about, and that is sea level. And shooting stuff in reference to sea level. Can you kind of expand on that a little bit?
Well, the ones I shot that were tied to sea level were the larger jobs, like I mentioned before. They had longer life expectancies, some 50 or 100 years. When you survey something and it's designed and built based on that survey, you want a home base. You want a certainty, an absolute. If something were to fail, something to go wrong, anybody, even after you retire or maybe you're dead and gone, on these 100-year practices, that you've got to have what they call a benchmark, a permanent benchmark, something that is certain. And not only the jobs that I've been involved in, but you look at iconic man-made structures. I looked up Hoover Dam. Anybody can do this, and it's tied to elevation above sea level, because when you think of it, when you have to come up with something that's going to be left untouched, undisturbed through the life of this practice, 100 years maybe or more.
Yeah.
But what better to use than the elevation of the sea? Not to mention, and I can only speak for in the state of Missouri, and I can say this with certainty because I've seen them with my own two eyes, and I've used them to do my job. In the state of Missouri, the old-timers told me they were placed like back in the 40s. We just arbitrarily throughout the state in rural areas, there are these concrete discs. They're flat. They lay on the surface of the ground. It's almost as they have a stem to keep them in place, but I can't assert to that for sure. But and it's 2.5 diameter concrete disc, and embedded in the very middle is a steel plate that's engraved. And it, don't quote me on this, but it would say something to the effect USGS Geological Survey certified 728 feet above sea level.
Yeah.
And the number would be real big.
Yep.
So on these big jobs, we would start and finish our survey. It's called closing your circuit. You'd start on that known certainty, and then you would conduct your survey. Some of these surveys would take days, and then we'd close our circuit, and we'd have to be within a tenth of a foot accurate.
Wow. So just barely over an inch.
Right.
Yeah. Wow. So, and these markers, yeah, and I'd heard about this, that the other surveyor said the same thing, which was, he said that these markers, no one had ever seen one ever get placed, but they were just part of this book. This USGS book that, you know, these markers, you may have to use them depending on what you're building, but they would be around here and there, and they were part of. In fact, he thought it was quite a revelation that these were the guys that put this down. The same guys that I mentioned in the clues that were tied to the azimuthal equidistant map, And, you know, they were the ones that used that, and, you know, also tied to the UN flag. You know, not to say the USGS is part of this giant conspiracy to hide what we know as the shape of the world, but it is interesting that they are the map makers, and they are the ones that lay out. I mean, they're basically keeping the whole thing going.
They certainly are, and a lot of agencies and even private sector work off, I think, of topography maps. We use those a lot.
Yeah.
And they were based on elevation above sea level, where lines, increments of 5 feet in elevation, you can just look at a topography map and tell if it's steep or flat.
Yeah.
And they always are, they have numbers, and those numbers on those lines represent elevation above sea level. And if we're living on a ball that's 25,000 miles in circumference, elevation of sea level really doesn't mean anything.
Next, we're going to hear from an air traffic controller interviewed by Mark Sargent. This air traffic controller said that he could see aircraft on radar up to 350 miles away. These aircraft should have been many miles below the curvature of the Earth and invisible to radar.
Across to Jonathan Walter, and he's talking about how he can fly an aircraft for 100 miles and he doesn't have to adjust anything on his aircraft, and he can just fly straight and level. And all of a sudden it dawned on me, oh my God, I was an air traffic controller. I have the hardcore proof. I mean, forget this laser beam test. I'm watching, you know, airport surveillance radar at aircraft 350 miles away. I'm receiving a radar blimp. I can see their altimeter. I can see the airspeed. I can see everything. And so I was bored one night, and the facility manager said, hey, why don't you set that scope and set out to 350 miles? And I'm scratching my head going, what? The radar goes to 350 miles? You've got to be kidding me. There's limited range of radar.
Yeah.
And we were told that to overcome this range is the E-2 Hawkeye aircraft that would fly and extend the range of the radar back to the aircraft carrier.
Sure.
Never once were we told about anything about curvature of the Earth.
Yeah.
Not once.
No. Why would no? Yeah, nobody else has been told that either, apparently.
No, it was not part of my training. So I said I was perplexed, set my scope at 350 miles, and sure enough, I could see aircraft at 350 miles away, no problem. And I started, you know, I didn't know anything about the curved Earth. I didn't know about the equation. And I started pulling out my calculator, and I'm like, okay, at just 300 miles away, which was a clear radar blimp, mm-hmm. at 350, they got a little fuzzy.
Yeah.
But we're talking about 81,666 feet. And aircraft don't fly that high unless, you know, classified mission.
Oh, of course. That. Yeah, yeah.
You know, and I'm reading their airspeed and their altimeters, and I dialed it down. I'm watching Boston traffic and, you know, the whole traffic pattern, because I'm, you know, I'm interested in that kind of things and how civilians control aircraft, because it's a little bit different than the military.
Sure.
And then I'm sitting there going, well, it's impossible, according to these equations, for me to see the Boston traffic. I shouldn't have been able to see it.
Yeah. Yeah. And you're following it. And forgive me if I'm giving the wrong terms. Jonathan's probably better at this than I am. So you're following them all the way into the Boston airport?
Oh, yeah. Hey, I wasn't watching their altitude and airspeed, but yeah, I'm watching them hit the ground. Clear day, cloudy day. I don't care what kind of day it was. You could have the worst weather in the world.
Yeah.
And I could see the whole eastern seaboard. No problem.
In the next video, Mark reads a letter from an Australian intelligence officer and defense engineer. This well-experienced officer stated that the satellite communications and GPS were indeed ground-based.
From 1997 through to post 9/11, I worked in signals intelligence for a branch of the Australian Defence Force called the Defence Signals Directorate. Mm-hmm. For a period of time, I was based at our prime intelligence facility, but had worked alongside U.S. intelligence officers since I began, primarily USN, United States Navy, liaison officers. Before I kick off, let me say this. One of the first things that stood out for me was pilots, navigators, and aircraft crew rarely help higher than secret clearance. Rarely help higher? Well, whatever you wrote there. Mm-hmm. The security briefings I attended and supported were levels above their need to know. And when I questioned this, I was told field assets are never given all the facts in case they are compromised, captured. Makes sense. As a result, they are heavily compartmentalized and trust that their mission profiles have been generated with all the facts and really are outside of their operational scope. So when I hear Mark talking to pilots, navigators, and even weapon system operators, this comes to mind. Anyway, post my time with Intel, I joined BAE Systems, formerly British Aerospace, as a senior hardware engineer assisting the design, development, and handover of Australia's first airborne early warning and control aircraft, otherwise known as Wedgetail. Due to my background with intelligence, BAE bent over backwards to bring me in, since one key role of the aircraft was to establish intelligence feeds for our defense analyst. One of my initial tasks was to develop a simulator, racks of equipment, which demonstrated how data feeds were pulled and disseminated within the classified intelligence centers. My past colleagues certified the suite, and I was given a chairman's award. I went on to collect one more during my time with BAE and another nomination. My role is detailed in the above profile link, which I'm not going to send you guys because it actually has his name in it. As the project began to wind down, I moved to Raytheon and joined the Air Warfare Destroyer Program, which is our country's first AEGIS destroyer. I have been with them for 7 years and initially joined as engineering lead for the very short-range defense capability. Again, see my link for a breakdown on that. Mm-hmm. Australia has a significantly smaller military than most countries, so we are very good at intelligence gathering and enhancing the engineering of our field assets to identify and reduce vulnerabilities. I have become intimately familiar with my two systems, the MK-15 Phalanx and MK-25 Typhoon, and part of my mandate was to find and patch weapon system vulnerabilities. The USN sail in large fleets, so they are less concerned about minor vulnerabilities in systems. We do not have the luxury, so our ship has evolved into one of the more advanced, Aegis ships on the water. My systems have been successfully integrated as of November 2015, and for the past 12 months, I have been working as a combat system field services engineer, a team of four for three $12 billion ships. My role now is to support all equipment through sea trials, which has given me unfettered access to current weapon systems, their capabilities, and a conduit to the OEMs, which has led to many interesting discussions over beers. Typhoon system, for example, has an aerospace top light camera optical system on a ground-based 25mm chain gun. Its active range is to 3 kilometers, but the top light allows you to range much further. When accepting it in Israel, I was ranging targets with the laser at 35 or higher kilometers away, nothing to account for curvature. Our ship uses GPS and as a secondary only. For years, I have been aware that should war break out, the civilian band GPS is shut down and only military band is available. We have military-controlled GPS antennas called DAGRS, which is D-A-G-R-S, which we use as a backup only for our weapon systems when in a war zone. It's recently come to my knowledge that shutting down civilian GPS is done through electronic warfare jamming, not shutting down satellites, which our ship is very capable of doing, as it is the Wedgetail AEWNC I worked on prior to this program, which means GPS is carried on a spectral frequency like radio waves. Mm. Our electronic warfare capabilities provide the ship with far superior position location compared to the GPS system. Observations. When I was working in the Australian Joint Intelligence Center, one of my tasks was to maintain SATCOM intelligent feeds and data links. I won't get into detail, but a few things have always stuck with me. Engineers hold higher clearance than analysts. This is because we may be exposed to higher intelligence during the process of gathering data. Logically, to better support the analysts, I was working in isolation of orders and outside my compartmentalization to establish a map of sorts for my feeds and links. This was telling me that all my data feeds were coming from ground-based sources, which I initially translated as the satellites were beaming data to classified ground installations, which were relaying the data to us. All right. The reality, though, was nothing more classified than us We were the intelligence hub. When confronting my commanding officer about this, I was told I was operating outside of my clearance and ceased any further investigation.
Next, Mark reads an email from a corporate travel agent who said that flights simply do not make sense on a globe, and that these discrepancies are actively being changed to hide the flat Earth truth.
There we go. It's from corporate travel agents. Hello, Mark. About a month ago, my father had brought up to me some flat Earth evidence. Of course, the first thing I did was laugh, but I only laughed once as I began to listen to some evidence and it all clicked in for me. As a corporate travel agent for over 20 years, I started to remember all the times the clients inquired about the length of their flight times. There were so many cases that it did not seem to make sense, and they were looking to me for a reasonable explanation. Normally, I would agree with them that the flight time seemed longer than it should be, but then and then the person would automatically brush it off and put it out of their mind. So next, I immediately went to my airline system to look up flight times. I specifically looked at nonstop flights as they are easier to compare long-haul flights against each other. When I closely compared flights, my heart sank as I realized it was true. There is no reasonable explanation for all the inconsistencies. I wanted to give you a good example, but something surprising happened. I had previously checked certain city pairs, such as Sydney, Australia to Johannesburg, South Africa, versus Tokyo, Japan to Istanbul, Turkey. These cities should be similar distances apart according to the globe map model. The flight time from Australia to Africa was more than 4 hours more than the flight in the Northern Hemisphere. This supports the flat Earth model. A month ago, I checked many city pairs, and every time it was obvious that there was a huge discrepancy. The problem is that I checked again today so that I could give you some specific examples, and suddenly the flight times have changed to look more as they should on a globe Earth. They may be now using aircraft that flies faster, doubt it, for the longer hauls, and the truth is that the flights often come in now much earlier or later than their planned schedule predicts. So the interesting part is that it appears they have taken the time to adjust all the flight times since they are now under the radar of the flat Earth movement. This is really interesting because it shows that they are running scared of getting caught in this big lie. Another interesting tidbit is that my ex-husband is an aerospace engineer working on NASA contracts. I have long been skeptical of the moon landing and have asked him many questions to see if he could verify anything to be true, as they say. He had no idea on this subject. His company had him working only on small parts of each project and contract at any given time, and he was not informed about the whole picture. He only concentrated on his part of the project. So it is definitely very compartmentalized there at, and I'm not supposed to mention the aerospace subcontractor, but gotcha. You guys can probably take a guess. And he, of course, got angry with me for questioning any of it. Ha ha. So this information may not be concrete enough to change anyone's mind, but I thought you might find it interesting.
The next video is a communication from a defense intelligence agent who states that all space rockets and stations are impossible in a vacuum devoid of air and oxygen. According to this expert, combustion engines cannot work in a vacuum.
Mark, please comment on the following formulation. Since all space vehicles are powered by rocket fuel-filled combustion engines, and since NASA asserts that space is, in essence, a vacuum devoid of air and certainly devoid of oxygen, and since combustion engines can only work by burning fuel in an ambient atmosphere comprised of oxygen to support the combustion reaction, then how could any NASA space vehicle have propelled itself through the so-called vacuum of space? This includes manned and unmanned rockets, satellites, telescopes, space shuttles, and space stations. In that context, one also ponders how the space shuttle Columbia in 2003 could have exploded in that same asserted vacuum of space. To that, while I believe one can create a spark in a vacuum with a small supply of nitrogen and oxygen, or oxygen, I do not believe that a vacuum devoid of air can support a propagated explosion. Formulation: neither propulsion by combustion nor the propagation of an explosion can occur in a vacuum devoid of air. Most important is that within the construct put forth by NASA, that the universe, which lies beyond our atmosphere, is an infinite vacuum. The associated assertion by NASA that rocket-fueled combustion engines propelled themselves through that vacuum is completely impossible. This incredible flaw in NASA's staging and choreography of astrophysics through the authority is even more fundamental than the flaw that others use to invalidate these missions, that propulsion in a vacuum cannot occur as a function of the third law of thermodynamics, an argument which is interesting, but which is completely unnecessary to consider since more fundamentally, a rocket's combustion engine cannot even work in a vacuum. Mark, if you can invite a legitimate scientific specialist onto your show in order to have him or her confirm this formulation with hard data, then perhaps an even larger segment of the population will realize that everything NASA publishes, the photographs, data, astrophysical metrics, videos, and press releases are all completely and fundamentally phony to the core. These observations are noted in the context of the absurd notion that human beings somehow do not feel the asserted motion of the Earth spinning at over 1,000 miles an hour, while revolving at over 65,000 miles an hour, and while soaring through the vacuum at over 500,000 miles per hour. The notion is even more absurd when you realize that human beings do feel the motion of a car moving at 10 miles an hour. Regards, RG.
The next video is from a U.S. Army field artillery radar operator who said that the radar beams in the system he used had to travel out an impossible 30 miles and that no curvature was ever taken into consideration. I also included a small video describing the same radar system. 30 miles equals 600 feet of curvature.
For me. So it's by anonymous and he goes into a little bit of back history, and I think it's fair, and I'm not going to edit any of it out. I'm going to read it as is, just so everybody knows, and hopefully he's listening, and I know he is. This statement is written with the intention to help people wake up to the truth that we do not live on a spinning globe circling a gigantic distant sun. I will tell you about me. At the age of 32, the year 2005, I accepted Yeshua the Christ in my heart and was transformed to a new person with a fresh new way of thinking. Immediately, inspired by the Holy Spirit, I began to understand the scriptures, which revealed a different universe, as we have been taught. After reading at that time, I knew the moon missions were faked, and still it never crossed my mind the truth of the flat earth or plateau. That was the little thing you put in there. I decided to proof the universe. I knew through the words of the Bible and always found myself questioning the endless space. I understood that the God of the Bible did not intend for humans to reach the stars, more or less the firmament. The story of the Tower of Babel is clear enough proof that God will not allow humans to reach across the barrier dome. Moreover, the simple statement of "look up and praise the Lord" may be questioned, the globe having skies all around. By default, I can be looking down and still look towards God's throne or his domain. Still to this moment, the flat earth never crossed my mind. Fast forwarding here to the year of 2010, the age of 37, when I joined the United States Army. Got in pretty late. My job in the electronic maintenance section is to fix and maintain the field artillery radars operational. I had 1 year of training from the history of radio waves to the radar technology of today, and through all the training, sometimes in the back of my mind was telling me something is missing here for these radars to work appropriately. This is the equipment capable of generating up to 120 kilowatts to amplify the 2.4 gigahertz frequency in order to shoot the pencil beams downrange to a maximum distance of 50 kilometers or 30 miles. By the way, the 2.4 gigahertz frequency spectrum involves the Wi-Fi and satellites communications. You can search the communication sheet on Wikipedia by typing the electromagnetic spectrum. And he sent me one of those, and it's really, really cool. I encourage anybody to look at it. It's a little hard to read because it's so jam-packed with stuff. But anyway, so I get deployed to Afghanistan, and the first day on the job, I find the operators discussing whether or not the radar could actually track anything according to the position of the geography of the area. In the middle of their conversation, I suddenly came to this absurd idea and spoke, "Well, I think the beams should follow the Earth's curvature in order to work at such distances, right?" The look they gave me was enough for me to stay out of the conversation. Then, after thinking of the statement, I asked myself, how in the world are we actually tracking anything if the beams shoot straight then eventually they would shoot out into space, and still no idea of the flat Earth. It wasn't until this year, 2015, that my wife started showing me the images. Thank you, by the way, to Mr. Anonymous's wife, from what I think are from Rob Skiba's website. I ignored her. What, not my website? What, I'm not good enough? That's fine. That's totally fine. I ignored her for a while because I was too busy with work and the present. Also, I kind of been upset with humanity because they just won't believe there's a God or an intelligent creator. One day around the beginning of summer, while sitting in the motor pool at the radar, I decided to hear one of Rob's radio broadcasts. Wow, my brain just clicked literally. I felt it going down my spine and boom, another layer dropped from the scales on my eyes. Oh, neat. The fact that Rob used the Bible and the Book of Enoch, which I began reading years back, but stopped because it did not match our reality of the globe. Since then, I can't stop the research, and wow, now I can look up and say, yes, my God. Back to the radar. So the pencil beams start in comparison with the point of a pencil, and it widens to a cylindrical shape, which we already knew because Jaron ran into that accidentally when he was shooting that beam across the water. Anyways, the rockets or any projectile needs to break the plane that these beams create at the lowest level of the mountain peaks, which brings us to the curvature equation and the discrepancy of elevation. The beams have to travel on a flat trajectory track. Anything at 30 miles out and the curvature is a 600-foot drop, there can be no accuracy. Like the other military men have stated on Mark Sargent's radio broadcast, no curvature is ever taken into consideration with any weapon. I would like to include images here, but you can search them online at Wikipedia. There is information on this radar. It is the AN-TPQ-37 radar system and the spectrum frequency chart. Signed, Anonymous.
Deployed well back from the forward edge of the battle area, the ANTPQ-37 long-range, range-gated pulse Doppler radar system employs a phased array antenna to automatically scan the horizon many times a second, forming a 90-degree wide electronic blanket over the battlefield. Any projectile passing through this electronic blanket is automatically detected and tracked while the search beams simultaneously continue to search the selected 90-degree sector for other projectiles.
The following video is a short letter from an aviation family who found the Flat Earth truth and realized that aviation supported a Flat Earth.
Greetings. We are a third-generation aviation family. My husband's grandfather was a general aviation pilot. His father was also a general aviation pilot. My husband has over 6,000 hours as a commercial ATP, that's A as in Apple, T as in Tom, P as in pilot, and was also a flight instructor. I first stumbled onto your videos being the wife of a pilot with 100 hours of flight time myself. I thought this issue would be easy to debunk, like the aliens. It must be all a big joke. When I realized, however, that aviation was being used to debunk the globe Earth model, I was in shock because nothing stated about the physical science of aviation could be disputed. At first, my husband laughed when I told him about the possibility of the Earth being flat. Once he started listening and studying it all, he quickly changed his tune. He began to test various aspects of the globe math and superimpose it upon the physical science of aviation, navigation, and avionics. It did not hold water. Indeed, a globe cannot hold water. I believe for us, we were able to let the globe go more quickly than others because we realized that we had indeed experienced the flat Earth in aviation. It is hard to come to grips with the fact that we have had a career in the field where the truth of our Earth was in plain, P-L-A-N-E, sight, and we never saw it. Our father and grandfather did not recognize it. It speaks to the tremendous power of suggestion and indoctrination we receive in school to eliminate the truth from its very obvious nature.
Next is a Mark Sargent interview with a professional pilot instructor. Like Bob from Globusters, the pilot affirmed the gyroscopes in the airplane do not account for curvature. Furthermore, the pilot stated that the airplane can fly a couple hundred miles and maintain level flight throughout with no adjustment for curvature. an absolute impossibility under the globe model.
It says, Mark, I have been listening to your show for the last month or so, and I want to share my professional opinion on one of your recent topics. I am a professional pilot and certified flight instructor. I run my own business at a smaller airport in the Midwest. In my previous 6 years teaching others how to fly, I can absolutely verify that your recent guest's claims about the gyroscopic properties of the aircraft's altitude indicator are correct. Robert did a great job in describing how it works, and he was spot on. Never in any textbook or other literature have I read anything about correcting for a curved Earth. We rely on those instruments in bad weather and literally risk our lives, trusting that the instruments will not deviate from straight and level ever. That's in all caps. That alone was proof enough to a well-educated pilot to question everything I thought I knew, and am now very much convinced that we have some serious examining to do regarding the world in which we live. We're going to get right back into it with the flight instructor from Iowa. He's going to tell us more about why he thinks the world is flat. And hey, I agree with him, so let's get right to it.
Cool. Here we go.
Just to prove this, to show people that don't get the perspective, you know, like you say, you know, people that don't do this every day.
Yeah.
But if you just put a camera on the altimeter to show how high above sea level you are, and one on the attitude indicator, and you could do this all in with one camera. You could do it in one shot with one camera, and then have it, you know, also kind of partially looking outside so you can see visually where you're at. And if you could just take that aircraft and the pilot held his altitude and maintained the same altitude, you could fly from here. I could fly, you know, 200 to 300 miles in any direction, just about, and nothing would change. Nothing would change whatsoever. And if you do the math, you know, I mean, if you're talking a couple hundred miles, I should be gaining, you know, just within 100 miles. What is it, like 6,000 feet or something?
Yeah.
You know, so, and the altitude will be straight and level.
Yeah. Yeah. So again, you know, I know there's a lot of people out there that maybe aren't quite getting this. And that is, look, the gyro system, from what everybody has said so far, including John here, only appears to work correctly if it's working on a flat plane. Because if it wasn't, you would just, if you try to keep it level, whether if you're in a submarine, you're just going to keep going up until you surface. And if you're in a plane, you're just going to keep increasing altitude until you leave the Earth. If the Earth was curved.
Yep. Yeah, the only way it can work is on a flat plane. The only way that gyro would be accurate the way it is accurate, the way we read it as we do, is if we're on a flat plane.
Now, I really enjoyed this fairly technical email from an industrial valve expert. It's longer than the rest of the videos, as I couldn't add much in my opinion. He essentially says that the International Space Station is a 100% fraud. Based on his professional understanding of seals, valves, fluid control, and machining, there's no way that the ISS could survive in space. His argument is very convincing. His same arguments can be used to prove that the moon landings never occurred and that there won't be a mission to Mars.
So, per our conversation, I am sending you this letter. As we discussed, at this point, I must stay anonymous. The fluid control industry is a small village. Let us just say I am a professional in the valve industry. The point of this letter is to draw attention to certain aspects of seals, valves, and actuators that must be part of any artificial environment to maintain life and functionality. I have no special knowledge of the ISS, but there are principles of fluid and motion control that cannot be ignored. We assume that the ISS has supply systems for water, fuel, air, etc. These systems would all require valves, pumps, and seals at a bare minimum. Without systems to deliver, send, expel, vent, filter, and store these fluids and gases, life on board would be impossible. Tubing, pumps, tanks, and valves would need to be present across all of the living areas to assure, at the least, fresh air. Seals, such as O-rings, would be required throughout the ISS to hold in gases and fluids. Valves would be required to meter these gases and fluids and to maintain proper pressures. Actuators would be required to move devices such as the Canadian arm, hatch openings, etc. Anything that is not moved manually requires an actuator. Let's look at some of the questions that pose a problem. Okay, so that was the end of his little preface. And then he goes into the first thing he wants to address is seals. And here we go. For aerospace applications, the most commonly used seals and O-ring materials, and we're going to get into a couple technical things here, are GLT-type fluorocarbons, generically ASTM D1418 type 3 elastomers. I don't know that word very well, which have a glass transition temperature of negative 30 Celsius. Materials of this type that meet the new AMS 7287 and predecessor AMSR 83485 specs have a useful operating temperature down to negative 40 Fahrenheit and up to 400 degrees Fahrenheit. Even though this is an impressive temperature range, it appears that the ISS is being exposed to temperatures beyond this range. There are special Teflon-based seals available that can extend a little past this range, but they are not made with flexible or compressible materials. Therefore, the mating components would have to be manufactured within a millionth of an inch tolerance to prevent a seal from moving and thus leaking. Not convenient for a hatch or a fuel valve that is in constant use. Perhaps the seals are shielded from the temperature changes. Perhaps. But the outside of the ISS does not seem to show the insulation units required to accomplish this. Another problem with seals is that they wear out. Seals would have to be replaced frequently. Preventative maintenance of seals and sealing services would keep a maintenance team busy 24 hours a day. Seal replacement would require sealing off areas, cleaning and sealing surfaces, since in many cases a human hair can cause a seal to leak, lubrication, polishing sealing services, or replacement of modules, etc. I do not think any of these things have been observed on the ISS. Seals also require back pressure to seal. I have no idea how a seal would function against a vacuum. We have no calculation for it. Any seal I have ever seen would simply be sucked out into space. How fuel, air, water, etc. are all contained and moved in the ISS, I have no idea. The seals of the ISS must be flawless, maintenance-free, immune to temperature changes, basically miracles of modern science. We in the industry would hold such mythical seals in awe and reverence if they existed. He says, valves would be needed aboard the ISS for many life-sustaining reasons, fuel, air, water, ammonia, etc. And then he takes an excerpt from literally space.com, right? And this is, you know, this is from the guys that are up there, right? So this is their quote. He says, and then he comments on it. So it says, the International Space Station's active thermal control systems, the ATCS, pump fluids through closed-loop pipes. A liquid ammonia coolant loop along the station's main truss keeps the station's electricity-generating solar panels cool. An ammonia pump on the main truss failed in 2010 and had to be replaced by spacewalking astronauts. The Expedition 35 crew on the International Space Station reported an ammonia leak near that same location 3 years later in 2013. Liquid ammonia circulates through the pipes, carrying waste heat from the solar panels to the photovoltaic radiator panels, where the heat escapes into space. This keeps the solar panels cool. So then he comments. He says, so there it is. The ammonia is pumped. Pumping requires valves. What valve can function in extreme temperatures in a vacuum? Since a spacewalk was required to repair the unit, it is obviously exposed to the vacuum of space. The seal issue mentioned above would be a major problem. How would they perform degaussing? And people don't know what that is. It's the process of decreasing or eliminating a remnant magnetic field of the valve for it to function properly, since they are never grounded. When these astronauts replaced the pump, how was this accomplished without depressurizing the entire ammonia supply? How does one do that in a vacuum? I watched this procedure on space.com. It was clearly done underwater. plastic pieces floated upwards, etc. No residual ammonia and the broken pump was emitted. No lubrication applied. The list goes on. Valves require venting. Excess pressure has to go somewhere. It is vented in, is it vented into space? Would that not suck all the gases and fluids out into the vacuum of space since there is no back pressure in space? Are gas valves vented to the interior of the space station, increasing the pressure in the living areas to dangerous levels? Valves require filtering. Are filters changed frequently? Are there three maintenance teams working 24/7 to maintain the filters? Because if a filter fails and stops a valve, it could kill everyone on board. Consider a commercial airliner. Consider how much maintenance one airliner needs to stay in the air. Think about the fuel pumps, the air exchange, and the seal replacement programs. Valves are maintained and changed out frequently. Now consider the ISS in this light. One little pump's change out in 2010 and a little repair in 2013? Does NASA have valves that function in impossible environments and seals made of unobtainium and unicorn tears? I am guessing no. Actuators, or air cylinders, are the muscles of moving machinery. Pumps are the heart of the machinery that pump fluids and gases to drive the machines. Valves control the pressures and quantities of the fluids and gases. Actuators push and pull to give the machines movement. They have been used for decades to drive the Industrial Revolution forward. They are the muscles of robots that move their limbs. They hold the hood open on your car so you can check the oil. They open and close the hatches on submarines. They drive needles that weave carpets. They are all around us in every mechanical system. Some are driven with pneumatic air pressure. Some use hydraulic fluids. And some are electrical. Let us look at the types briefly. Pneumatic, otherwise air-driven. On the ISS, how would these work? The seal issue is certainly a big problem. Actuators need valves. We covered these problems already. Piston rods rely on dynamic seals and are prone to leakage. Temperature is an issue. Ice cream makers and metal forges struggle with actuators due to the extreme temperatures that they deal with. But consider that they only deal with their end of the temperature range. Ice cream makers deal only with extreme cold. Metal forges deal only with extreme heat. What kind of Vulcan technology, and I'm sure that's a Star Trek reference there, is NASA using to handle both temperature extremes, let alone in a vacuum? Hydraulic or fluid-driven. The same problems as pneumatics apply here as well. In addition, hydraulic actuators drip and weep oil. The ISS would become uninhabitable without constant maintenance. Where would the fluid be stored, disposed of, replaced, etc.? Electronic. This is probably the most probable type NASA would claim that they use. They are clean and function without the exchange of pressurized substances. What about maintenance, lubrication, degaussing, replacing motors, drives, belts, circuits, panels? Certainly, they would be prone to shorting out and requiring constant care, especially since they cannot be grounded. Consider satellites, but that's another topic. Changing out components is not like changing the brush heads on a vacuum cleaner. Lastly, and probably the most important problem, is there's no machine shop. All dynamic systems require installation and maintenance. No matter how carefully designed and how advanced a system is, something will require machining. All large Navy craft, I'm looking at you, Sean, have onboard machine shops. The reason that I use ships and submarines as examples is that they are the most similar systems to the ISS that we can relate to. They are moving, large, self-contained, and functioning in hostile environments. Navy vessels must be able to repair, modify, or replace anything on board. Even under the best conditions, metal will warp, screw threads will strip out, seals will leak, welds will break, metal sealing surfaces will get scratched, tubes will crack, electronics will short out, motors will overheat, motors will freeze up, critical tools will break, belts will break, cables will snap, etc., etc. Ad infinity. The ISS appears to not have a machine shop whatsoever. How are repairs done? Are we to believe that all the replacement parts are flawless modules that snap together perfectly every time like Legos? Are there sea containers full of replacement parts floating next door? Is there never a time that a critical threaded hole is stripped out and needs to be retapped? Do parts never warp in the extreme temperatures and need to be resurfaced? Is there welding equipment up there? Submarines have welding equipment. They can even weld underwater. What happens in the event of a structural event that requires welding? I know that Captain Kirk and Spock repairing the Enterprise using a phaser as a welder, but this is supposed to be real. Of course, the chance of fire is too great to weld, but structural damage happens and has to be calculated into the plan. As far as I know, it's not. Regarding fire hazards, machine shops throw sparks, lots of sparks. Even if you could haul a lathe, Bridgeport, and drill press up to the ISS, the danger would be too extreme. This is where NASA shot themselves in the foot. For short missions, days, even weeks, this would not be an issue. But when the missions are years long, no. The ISS is great theater, but it is not reality. Thank you, the Valve Guy.
In the next video, Mark reads an email from an expert in commercial shipping. The individual helps customers with international shipping issues. He said that shipments in the Pacific did not make sense as all of the shipments went past Alaska, which only supports a flat Earth map.
My name is blank, and I work with this company as a senior customer support in international trace department. Okay? Mm-hmm. I have been following your work for some months now after finding Eric's work first. Hope he starts unifying instead of dividing. Listen up, Eric. Anyway, my job is to help customers if they have any issues with their shipment stock, mainly in customs overseas. So I had this situation with a package going from Guam to Oakland, California. The package got to its destination late, and the shipper wanted to know why the shipment went to Alaska first, then Japan, and then finally Guam. Right? So it was going from Oakland to Guam, and it bounced off Alaska, then Japan, then Guam. This is the normal route for shipments going to Asia or the South Pacific. All shipments going or coming from these regions go to Alaska first. She couldn't understand why the package didn't go from Oakland to Hawaii, which all of us, that's what I would have done. So Oakland to Hawaii, then Guam, as the globe map will show. Common sense, right?
Mm-hmm.
I have to give her all kinds of excuses for the route this shipment took. Believe me, I wanted to tell her, hey, lady, get a flat Earth map and you'll see what's going through, why it's going through Alaska. It's almost a straight shot.
Now we're going to hear from a Navy missile operator, and this interview is terrific. The Sea Sparrow missile operator claimed that he could see and target ships that should have been well below the curvature, even 58 miles away. 58 miles is equal to 2,243 feet of curvature. He also discusses Polaris, a later key proof in my series.
How many years did you do on the, and by the way, I've been boning up on this, on the WASP class Iwo Jima?
I did 5 years in total, yes.
And so, and what you were talking to me about yesterday is you with the Navy, they do like 5 years on at sea and then several years on land.
Yes, they just rotate us back and forth.
Okay, cool. And then, so for the last 3 years, you've been training people in the systems, in the Sea Sparrow system. That you've been that you learned for the last 5 years.
Yeah. What I did was basically went up on my roof and I built this apparatus is basically out of metal and wood, and it was basically acting like a bore sight. And I took one sight hole that was very small and put another sight hole about 10 foot away from it, and then fixed another stationary spot to be able to fix a camera in there. And basically what I did over the span of 5.5 months, I aligned this apparatus to the Polaris star. And as I time-lapse videoed it, the Polaris star never, ever once fell out of the sight hole whenever it was perfectly lined up to it. It never once did it.
5.5 months.
Five and a half months straight.
So when you were looking at the stuff, you mentioned to me that it was it started to put some stuff together, because you said when you were on tour that you know, on the seas, that there were certain things that were going on that didn't make sense to you, and I kind of wanted to go through them one by one. The first thing was you were mentioning to me about ships that you tracked in the distance that you could never ever determine any curvature no matter what. Can you kind of break that down for us?
Basically, without losing people, I guess.
Let's say we can go slow. It's okay.
For anyone that doesn't know, max observable distance, roughly, for the horizon out to sea is about 15 to 18 nautical miles, depending upon humidity and dew point and all of that. Okay. I've actually been outside with binoculars, with high powered telescopic devices. You know, we have access to certain things like that. Mm-hmm. And as a ship is perceived to be dropping below the quote unquote horizon, all you got to do is zoom in on it, and all of a sudden, poof, the bottom of the ship where it meets the water is back in observance again. This doesn't add up, because at 15 nautical miles, you know, there's several feet to be dropped around a curved Earth.
Yeah.
So it just doesn't add up at all.
Wow. And you noticed that on a regular basis, and did it bother you? You know, because you were in a vantage point that most people don't have, and that was you were in the middle of well, just about every type of ocean, but calm oceans, and you were viewing ships, you know, whatever, you know, I imagine most of them were various allied ships that are around, and you could see the bow no matter where you were. I mean, this was a consistent thing you were witnessing all over the place.
Yep. And you know, the thing was, I never thought about it at the time. I can only tell you the account I have of what I did out there. Mm-hmm. But like, it's something I just never thought about, because much like everybody today, it's not something you're just actively looking for. You go with the preconceived notion, and you know, you move about your day. You don't even think about it.
Yeah. Did you think, I mean, did you have any concept of what it was? I mean, did you think it was refraction? Did you think it was just, you know, a humidity issue, an optical illusion? Did anything cross your mind, or did you just kind of say, eh, that sort of stuff happens, I don't care, I'm going to go about doing my own thing?
It was kind of the latter that you just mentioned, but like, looking back on it, hindsight being 2020, and everything I've learned about, like, you know, refraction and mirages and all that stuff, and how mirages always are inverted. This wasn't a mirage. I could see the ship perfectly. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't cutting any of the image out. You know, it wasn't flipping it over. It definitely was the actual object. So,
yeah. Wow. That's fantastic. Tell us a little bit about the Sea Sparrow surface missile system, as far as how it tracks. So you're pointing, you're illuminating the target, correct, with that system?
Yes, and this is actually something that anyone can look up online.
Yeah,
you can go to Wikipedia and look this up
yourself. We're not giving away classified information here. This is fully something.
This is, they have whole pages about this. But basically, the way our system works is we're an 8-missile launcher, and we have other subsystems that basically allow us to produce RF, or radio frequency, that we illuminate any target with, you know, whether it be a threat or not. And that's how we track. It's by direct line of sight. And specifically, our fire control radar, we actually use a 2-degree pencil beam. It's a very, very tight beam, so there's very little room for deviation on that, and it's a direct line of sight radar.
Okay.
And we're able to track targets up to 50 nautical miles away. And on a curved Earth, that just doesn't add up.
Because, yeah, that should be impossible at 50 miles. And I'm looking at the chart, and I'll put this up on screen as we're putting this thing up on YouTube. But the chart, and this is very similar to the Chicago thing that's been going on. Have you kind of followed the Chicago skyline?
I have, 60 yeah. miles away across Lake Michigan. Yep, they can see the whole city.
There you go. So this is collaborating that, which he's saying he can track targets at 50 miles away, which should be about 1,700 if you round up, 1,700 feet below the horizon. But you're hitting them just fine.
Yeah. Wow. We're tracking them just fine.
Stand by for missile shot, and it'll cease battle too.
We have discussed how planes would necessarily have to make substantial adjustments for the curvature, but never do. Interestingly, the same applies to submarines. Because if the submarine maintains the same level, it would quickly jump out of the water due to the purported curvature of the Earth. In this interview, a Navy submarine captain says that they never made adjustments for the curvature. The submarine captain simply levels out the submarine, and the submarine maintains that angle for hundreds of miles, and the submarine never accidentally launches out of the ocean or loses its depth due to a failure to consider curvature. Now think about this. Ball believers claim that gravity acts as a magical leveling device for airplanes in the air. Do you really think that the force of gravity could also act as a natural leveling device for submarines as well?
Hey Mark, I am a retired Navy Chief Electronics Technician who has served on board 5 nuclear-powered subs over a 20-year career from 1988 to 2008. My life was puppies and rainbows until I stumbled onto your flat Earth clues. What were you thinking? But seriously, I was listening to your interview with Robert, the sailor from the target fleet. That's what us sub guys call surface ships, and got to thinking about how we drove submarines in the ocean and it would not work on a globe Earth. Why, you ask? Never, ever did we take the curvature of the Earth into consideration, nor did we ever consider gravity. It's similar to airplanes. And then he gave out his contact info, and for this show, his name is Jason.
Then when I was listening to your show that with Robert, the sailor guy.
Yep.
He was talking about his weapon system, and I think he brought up the gyro compasses and the accelerometers and things like that, and it just got me to thinking. And then the line of sight with the lasers.
Mm-hmm.
And it got me to thinking the way we drove the submarines around under the water.
Yeah.
And okay, and it really has nothing to do with the shape of the Earth when you think about the submarine, because we drive based on depth. All right.
Yeah.
So regardless of what the shape of the bottom of the ocean is, doesn't matter. But mainstream science claims, what about the surface of the ocean?
Yeah.
That it follows the curve of the globe.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're in a submarine underwater, and what we would do is when we're driving every 6 hours, you would do what we call trimming the ship. You'd log it in a book. What that means, you've got anywhere from a 380 to a 600 foot long tube.
Mm-hmm.
All right, and it's weights are distributed all about. People are moving around. You'd have to move water around in all these different tanks. We call them ballast tanks.
Okay.
To level out the ship, the trim of it fore and aft, the roll side to side, so that it runs smoothly and straight through the water on depth. At a certain speed.
Okay.
So we would go ahead and trim the ship, and we would try to trim it to where you would have your control surfaces like an airplane. You've got your front wings, your back stabilizers and all that on an airplane. Same thing on a submarine.
Mm-hmm.
So we would trim it to the point where we would go a certain speed with our control surfaces at zero angle with the angle of the ship on a zero angle, where a bubble is zero, like a plane would be level on the horizon.
Mm-hmm.
Submarine's bubble would be zero. And we would try to get exactly to that point where everything would be zero and you could maintain depth at that speed without touching anything.
Okay.
All right. It's sometimes it's difficult. Sometimes it's pretty easy. I'm not saying you can drive around for hours like that without having to make adjustments because people move around. You got to move water and things like that. But if you get your submarine on depth, let's just pick a depth of 200 feet, zero bubble at a certain speed, control surface is zero, it's not going to take you very long to notice that you're going to be going off depth because now your reference is the surface of the water, nothing to do with the bottom of the ocean.
Okay.
Reference is the surface of the water, according to mainstream science, has a curve to it, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Okay, so if you're at 200 feet, maintaining control surface is zero, and we can maintain depth within 1/10 of a foot on a submarine.
Okay.
So our instruments, we have digital readout. If you're at 200 feet, if you go to 199.9, you're going to know it. 199.8, 199.7. So after a while, it's not going to take you that long before you're poking your nose out of the surface of the ocean on a curved globe.
Yeah. Because if it's curved, the calculations, the sub is going to want to go up. It's naturally going to go up.
Yeah, because it's just driving through the water.
Yeah.
It only maintains depth by how we control it. It doesn't do it on its own.
Yeah.
So it's just this. It's like taking a pencil. If you just took a pencil, imagine you're holding this pencil in the ocean. You're a huge giant. Okay. You're holding a pencil in the ocean and you're pushing it straight across.
Yeah.
Completely straight. After a while, the tip of that pencil is going to come out of the curve of the ocean.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Okay.
Because you're not maintaining depth, you have your control surface zero, your bubble zero, and after a while you're just going to run out of curve. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if people can understand how I'm saying that. Can you guys understand it?
Yeah, because this is the argument, the airplane argument.
Exactly.
And that is if the airplane, because submarines are really just airplanes in the ocean like you had said. And if the airplane stays level, if it tries to stay level, eventually the curve is going to drop down below them and it's just going to keep increasing altitude. And if they had infinite power, they would escape the orbit of the Earth.
Yeah. And we were doing that at 172. I was actually flying it for about 10 minutes.
Yeah.
And we're going along.
Yeah.
And we're at about 1,000 feet. Mm-hmm. We're actually over the ocean, just right off the shoreline.
Mm-hmm.
And everything flat for the ice for as far as you can see. I think according to calculations, I was able to see about 67 miles out.
Okay.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to look at the tape that I took, and I'm going to try to pick any landmarks that are 67 miles out on a map and mm-hmm. see if I can actually see them on the tape.
Okay.
But what I noticed was we were doing about 100 miles per hour. And he had the elevators. You can lock in the rear elevators on the airplane at a certain angle to maintain your altitude.
Okay.
All right. And that's okay. What we were doing. All we were basically doing was moving the stick to fight the crosswinds. But we were flying along without nudging the nose down, nudging the nose up, or nothing like that.
Yeah.
For a long time. I'd say at least minutes and minutes, and we're maintaining our altitude within about 10 feet.
Yeah.
It was just a little bit of turbulence, you know, making us go up and down a little bit. But we weren't fighting altitude. We're just flat as a pancake.
In the next Mark Sargent video, we're going to listen to an interview with a retired United States Air Force navigator, pilot, and Air Force Combat Operations Officer. He says that because the horizon rises to eye level at any height, that the ball model must be false. Under the accepted ball theory, the horizon would necessarily have to recede as the airplane gets higher up, but it doesn't, and this should be noticeable and measurable. This is one of my primary proofs of the flat Earth as well that we'll discuss in a following video. The officer also adds that the curvature was never witnessed in all of his thousands of hours of flight.
Thomas's education includes a bachelor in aerospace
a master's, is that right, in space studies from one of the nation's leading, leading aerospace university with our honors. Is that right?
That's correct.
Perfect. Working on his MBA, currently enrolled in one of the nation's top-ranked business schools, but we're not going to say which one because there is some confidentiality stuff that we're going to be dealing with tonight. Relevant experience. Current position, he is a retired USAF. We'll just use those the acronym instead of the full-blown thing. USAF officer, but you're not that old. You're not that much older than me, but we're not going to say how old you are. And I know exactly what your current position is, but we are not going to reveal your current position with the government for professional reasons. However, it is highly relevant to the subject matter. He was a former USAF navigator, an instructor and evaluator, senior navigator with over 3,000 flying hours, flight scheduling chief for the largest tanker air wing in the world, special operations navigator, KC-135 air-to-air refueling subject matter expert. He is a USAF master air attack plans trainer, trained weapon system operators to build and conduct major theater air war in the Middle East, an air combat planner, air operations center combat planner during major combat in 2001 and 2003, force manager for air combat assets for the Middle East, a Middle East Islamic subject matter expert.
All right, so what did it for me? And again, I've got a background where I'm not just some guy that wouldn't know about such things like this. And I've got some sense, some background sense to understand if some of this is legit or not. But the thing that has done it for me most is that on a spherical object, if you rise in altitude away from that sphere, whether it's a basketball, whether you're an ant on a basketball, or whether you're on a 25,000-mile globe, the horizon must recede by very definition. It has to. And what we observe is that it never recedes. Folks say all the time, I hear them, and a few folks I've revealed this to that are retired Air Force folks, and they say, well, you're just not high enough. It doesn't work that way. You know, when we fly at 30,000 feet, you're 6 miles in the sky. But it should recede some measurable degree, but it doesn't. It never does, even when you're up to 30,000 feet at 6 miles high. Yeah. And that's the biggest thing for me, was that it never recedes. There's no observable curve, ever. I have a Thunderbird friend that he's an ex-Thunderbird, and he sends me a photograph. Yeah, there's a curve. And I said, no, this cloud's there. And he's like, sure enough, there's a cloud layer, and it's curved because it's cloud. But it's not to throw a rock at him, but we do that. I remember I'd sit at the beach and imagine that I could see the curve, but it's not there. I pull out old photographs. It's not there. You pull the straight line. There is no curve. There's no observable curve.
Yeah.
The next video is an excellent interview with a U.S. Army aviation and ground combat expert. He is also a pilot. Like the Air Force navigator earlier, the interviewee says, under the globe model, that the horizon should be under the globe model, the horizon should not continually rise to eye level, and so the official model must be false. As a ground combat expert, he affirms that the so-called Coriolis effect is also never taken into consideration in combat, even by snipers.
Steve has a 45-year background in aviation and ground combat operations. He is a commercial pilot, a flight instructor, an air traffic controller, an aircraft mechanic, and technical inspector. After high school, Steve joined the Air Force and worked in NORAD as part of the air defense community and was operationally connected to the Ballistic Missile Early Warning System, otherwise known as BMUSE. His degree is in aviation management. He has served as an airspace developer and ATC training office for the FAA. Steve is retired from the Army, where he was a sergeant major of the aviation training team, the Eagles, at the National Training Center in Fort Irwin, California. Steve had the unusual experience of serving as an enlisted Black Hawk pilot during Operation Desert Storm. He has vast knowledge of several military and enlisted Black Hawk pilots during Operation read that line again. He has vast knowledge of several military technologies, such as GPS and night vision devices. After retiring from the Army, he worked on the battle staff at the NTC, planning and directing combat training activities of up to 8,000 soldiers and vehicles. He transferred to Alaska as the project manager of a system similar to the one at the NTC. He has traveled across the Earth, conducting hundreds of operations and exercises for the U.S. and allied nations. He has spent most of his time overseas in the Middle East. So, all that being said, welcome, Steve, to the show.
This all started for me, Mark, over a course of years. I've observed things, right, which I'll talk about some of these things.
Okay.
And some of them, you know, the U.S. government gave me wonderful tools to observe them with.
Yeah.
And so I've always had questions, a lot of questions that have come up, mostly about is the Earth really spinning, and is it really circling around the sun?
Mm-hmm.
And that was always kind of the nature of my questions. But at the same time, I didn't dwell on that. I did not think about it all the time. There were times when, you know, it struck me as odd, or I'd be speaking with somebody about these things like, hey, how come these stars don't move, or something like that?
Mm-hmm.
But generally, you know, I do like everybody else. You know, I go to work, do my job so I can pay the rent, you know, put food on the table. And, you know, don't crash one of these things or drive into something, get shot by somebody or something stupid like that.
Yeah.
So, and all of that actually takes a bit of concentration.
Sure.
But I'm a poor consumer of news. I only go to one place, like the Drudge Report, right? And I like check it out.
Yeah,
because it's just a bunch of headlines, and you just read through them, and you know, some of them are funny, and if anything interests me, I'll click on it. Most of the stuff doesn't, but that's where I get my overview of the news of the day from.
Mm-hmm.
So, about 9 months ago, I'm looking at the Drudge Report, and here's this headline. It says, "Saudi cleric says Earth does not spin." And here's, you know, typical Saudi imam, you know, they're all younger, and so was he, and he's, you know, has on his scholar's robe.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, he's in somewhere in the United Arab Emirates, and he's talking about, say, he got like a question from the audience, hey, what does the Earth spin, you know? And I'm not sure whether someone was asking, you know, does the Quran say it or something?
Yeah.
But he speaks in Arabic, and there's a translator, and the guy's saying, look, the Earth doesn't spin. And here's how we can tell. If you take off in an airplane and you're flying over to China,
mm-hmm.
then all you got to do is just get up in the air and just wait for the Earth to, you know,
sure.
spin to you and land, and you're right there.
The old argument, yeah.
Yeah, and conversely, if you're China and you're trying to come back home, well, you'll never make it.
Yeah.
You know, that type argument.
Yeah.
He said, besides, you know, don't believe everything that you see on television or hear from the United States about they went to the moon, because that was all kind of done in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I thought about that for a while, because I've done a fair amount of flying in my time.
Mm-hmm.
And I've flown airplanes and I've flown helicopters. So I, you know, I'm pretty well up on that. But the whole question of does the Earth spin came flooding back to me.
Yeah.
All based on what this guy said when I clicked on it. So I did a search on, you know, just Google Earth spinning or something, spinning of the Earth. And I came across what I think is a very nice little presentation by Eric Dubay called 200 Proofs That the Earth Is Not a Spinning Ball.
Yeah.
And that one got me. That one really, really got me. There's a lot of things in there. But the thing that he brought up in that presentation was that no matter how high you go, the horizon of the Earth rises to meet your eye.
Yeah.
And that one freaked me out. And the reason it freaked me out is because that's always been one of my little problematic things.
When you were flying.
Yeah. And, you know, the gunnery thing speaks to the spinning of the Earth because of the so-called Coriolis effect.
Yeah.
And nobody takes that into consideration. Nobody. Well, that's it. Nobody pays any attention to that.
So, when you talk about the I'm sorry, you call it the Coriolis effect. I'm sorry, Coriolis factor.
Yes.
The you agree pretty much with everybody else, which is it's something that is talked about. Everyone's heard of it, especially in professional and the military sectors, but it's just never used in, for example, all the guys that I was talking to, they were used it in firing solutions, everything from a sniper to a, you know, through artillery up to a missile.
Yeah.
You know, not necessarily long range missile, but still a decent missile. It's just never factored into the firing solution.
Yeah, this Coriolis effect is something like Santa Claus and the Easter Bunny and the Tooth Fairy, man.
It's just not there.
It ain't there.
Yeah.
You know about it, right?
But yeah.
It's not there. You don't use it. Now, how I know about this is shooting. So I've done a lot of shooting in my time.
Yeah.
And because shooting is critical to what we do in the Army. That's, you know, what we're all about.
Yeah.
And accurate shooting is the best. And our best shooters are our snipers.
Mm-hmm.
And the best amongst the snipers, and I'm going to get it from the Navy SEALs here.
Go ahead.
The best snipers are the Marine Corps.
It's all right. They'll tout themselves as being that.
And those guys will. They wear Bill Blash uniforms, man.
Nice.
But you look in all of these manuals on, you know, sniping, man. There's not one – that word Coriolis doesn't even appear in there.
Yeah.
Now, we're going to hear from a tank master gunner who worked in the M1 Abrams tank. In the interview, he affirms that the gyroscopes inside the tanks – they keep the gun lined up with the target over many miles, never adjusted for the curvature of the Earth. In addition, he states that errant rounds were found without considering the curvature of the Earth and affirmed that no one considered the Coriolis effect when firing the tank guns.
So you did five tours, did Iraq. Would you consider yourself, I mean, master, help me out here because I know quite some about the military. Master gunner is a designation given to people that...
It's basically as tankers go up, our goal is to achieve to be a master gunner. We go away to school for a couple months and learn all the intricates of how to shoot the tank and how to maintain it and all the subject matter expert on how to make it work, basically.
Got it. That's cool. And so you're about as intimate as anybody regarding all the systems inside the M1? Or is it, what was it called, the M1A1 now or A2 or what?
We're on the M1A2 SEP.
Wow.
A system enhancement package.
Oh, cool.
Lots of computers.
I mean, I had a sniper instructor, you know, contact me and said, look, I trained for 3 years in the Marine Corps. He goes, the Coriolis effect does not take into, you know, it's not even in the manual.
No. The so background on the tanks to show you how precise they can be when calculate for, at least the computers and everything else, is things like barometric pressure, the ammunition temperature, the air temperature, crosswind, and any changes in those, and we demonstrate it, you know, in schools and whatnot, of how 10-degree difference will make the round totally different change.
Yeah.
But I can shoot east, west, north, or south, and it never affects if all those settings are in.
Nice, nice. I see. I didn't even. That's new to me. I didn't realize that. Now, barometric pressure doesn't necessarily surprise me because that's like water pressure. You know, if you've got, yeah, especially because you're shooting distances, and you don't have to give away anything. But I mean, you're shooting 20, 30 miles roughly. I mean, if you're
no,
not for the long shots.
No, not for the long shots. I mean, we average, your probably tanks will shoot target engagements 2 kilometers, but we can shoot, you know, around 4 kilometers or so accurately.
Accurately.
The move.
Okay.
So that's where the gyros and all that come in, but we can go across terrain up and down and hit a target out there.
Got it. Now, howitzers can shoot. You know, the artillery guys, they're designed to do the lob shots, but tanks rarely do any lob shots of any
kind. No, we don't do what's called indirect fire anymore. We're very direct. We like to see who we're, you know,
got it.
Shooting. But no, I will say the
– go ahead.
The rounds, so – and it's rare, but occasionally, you know, somebody will mess up and shoot a round too high or something, or, you know, out of the range that we're supposed to. Mm-hmm. And one thing that we're taught to do is, well, we have to find out where that round went.
Ah, got it.
So we know all the calculations, you know, given the angle and the temperature and the barometric pressure and all that, approximately where that round went. And they can go pretty far.
Got it.
Accidentally. But again, we don't count curvature of Earth to calculate where that round might have accidentally landed.
Good point. And yeah, let me address that here in a second. I want to clarify. So direct fire, that's target point to point. You know, you looking at an enemy piece and engaging them, usually a fairly horizontal shot. Tanks used to be, which is why I brought it up. Used to be, you know, they could park themselves, elevate the gun, and just start letting them fly. But you guys,
yeah,
but
that's, I think. M60 series was the last one to do that.
But that's it. Those tanks now, it's all about precision, and you guys don't, like you were saying, you don't take any random shots. It's all as accurate as possible. Kind of like a sniper.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's like a sniper. Once we shoot, well, they're going to know where we are, so.
Ah, good. Nice. All right, so when you guys are shooting, you know, let's say 4 kilometers or 2 kilometers, whatever your average is, your gyro is involved in that shot, right?
Yeah, so we have a stabilization system. So as we're moving across terrain or anything else, as you know, you're bouncing around, the gyros, when we activate them to activate the gun, keeps the gun on the target. So it keeps the gun wherever basically the gyro was pointed to keep it steady, including left and right and everything else. So no matter what angle I'm traveling at, if I'm holding that gun, then – gravity or not or anything else, that gun tube is going to stay exactly where it was last pointed.
Nice. And the perfect example of that is going over rises, you know, up and down hills, no matter what, that gyro is going to keep it, because it's tied via the computers to the gun. It's going to keep that gun right on target as much as possible.
Yes.
You don't understand what we're talking about, the Coriolis effect, and that is that the Earth is spinning, and if the Earth is spinning, mainstream science will tell you that it affects projectiles, you know, like cannon fire. There's people out there saying, oh yeah, it affects cannon fire. I'm going, well, there's a problem with that, with the military. And again, I'm a big military history guy, and you can attest to this, and that is, especially with tanks. I mean, artillery, for example, if you were going to engage a target, you would have to – not only would you have to figure out how far away it was and what kind of round you were going to use, but then you have to figure out, okay, which way am I facing? You know, northwest, southeast, you know, whatever you're facing. And then on top of that, you've also got to figure out – because remember, the spinning of the Earth is supposedly 1,000 miles at the equator, and then it ramps down all the way to zero at the North Pole. So you've got to figure out where you are on the globe. You've got to figure all this stuff in. And to my knowledge, I've never heard of anyone calculating these extra things when they're firing.
No, I've never heard of it either.
And you've done 5 tours and you've been, and not only, you know, yeah, you shoot tank rounds, but I'm sure you've had buddies in other branches. And no, let me ask you this. I'll throw you the question that kind of came out of the surveyor, because the surveyor said that not only did he never use the curvature of the Earth, but it was never even talked about. So in your case, did you, the Coriolis effect, you never even heard about that being discussed in any firing solution, as far as
no,
you know.
Never.
For this final video, we're going to listen to a merchant marine. He says that only flat earth maps are used by commercial shipping captains, and the curvature is never taken into consideration, especially when you move from map to map on long routes. These commercial shipping routes must be very precise to avoid underwater hazards, and that's impossible by using flat maps of a ball earth. He also says that he saw lighthouses that should have been well below the curvature.
The email goes something like this. Mark, my full name is Lee Womer, W-O-M-M-E-R, if anyone wants to check him out. I have been trying to get an email to you from my phone, but keep failing. As the subject reads, I was a ship captain by trade under the U.S. Coast Guard as a merchant marine, similar to the Air National Guard for reference. To keep this short, I studied and loved navigation on the ocean. I navigated difficult waters through coral reefs and many hazards in the Atlantic, primarily off the shore of South Florida. I also have a background in optics and engineering. Like many of your flat earth clues are part of what hit me. Sun rays at sunset, Polaris, a lighthouse I could see that I should not have seen, and technical navigation that I could not have done on a sphere literally hit me like a punch to the face about I don't know if that's 8 days ago or 8 weeks or 8 months. I think it's 8 months, isn't it?
8 months, yeah.
Okay,
maybe perfect. Maybe pushing 10 now, time flies.
Oh, that's true. I am also a Christian, so Rob Skiba interviews put it in cement for me. I would love to contribute and am happy to speak on air. I am amazed. I have amassed some surprising proofs. Like the other night, I was able to verify from a commercial airplane mechanic the location of the GPS antenna on large planes is under, all caps, the belly of the plane.
And you know, we've talked a lot about me being a ship captain, but then immediately I'm replaying in my head, if it's a sphere, you know, and you use the analogy of weak thins on a basketball, that's a really good analogy.
I was hungry when I said that.
I went back to actually my exam for getting my license. We had to plot courses, and it took me back to that particular chart and thinking about bending that chart around a ball, and that it does not work. You're going to get creases. And at first I was thinking you'd only get them along the longitude, but you would actually get them in either way, and it would be, you know, just taking you off in a curve of the wrong direction no matter what. And I navigated like between reefs that I couldn't see that would have torn holes in the bottom of the ships. And I would take divers out to a shipwreck in the middle of the Atlantic. And we had the way we did that, because it was pretty near the shipping lane. The shipwreck was, I think it was about 80 feet down to the shipwreck. And what we did was we took a 65-foot line, tied it off on the wreck, and then took a buoy, a deflated buoy, under. And then there's a little rig you can hook to your scuba gear that has an inflator nozzle on it. So we took a deflated buoy down 15 feet under the water at low tide, inflated it. So the shallowest that buoy would ever be would be under 15 feet of water. And, you know, I could manually plot right to that buoy and account for wind and current and everything else and take you right to that buoy on a flat piece of paper. So if you bent that piece of paper, even the distances I was going around a properly sized sphere, I never would have found that shipwreck. Never could have done it. It's not repeatable to navigate that way on a sphere. You could come up with a navigation system for a sphere, but we don't have it. And we don't use it. And those technical things have been kind of talked about a lot, but that was more of it. I just, you know, kept putting that wheat thin on the basketball and it cracks. Does not work. Yeah. And I kept trying to – you don't actually have to get that precise about it. All you have to really say is that here's my chart and here's a ball. And if I try to do this, it doesn't work. And so to determine exactly how it's going to throw you off, it's kind of irrelevant when, you know, there's a storm rolling in and you can't see the reef and you got to go, you know, through waters that are literally like 3 feet deep in a 8-foot draft boat, you know. Are you gonna wreck the thing, and you know, or are you not? And that's the kind of precision you have to have, and it just goes out the window. And you're saying that
precise navigation just does not work on a globe.
Yeah, not it just like, doesn't.
Yeah, and that's funny because what you were mentioning, and I don't know if a lot of people picked up on it, the very first subject matter guest I had, the Navy missile instructor. He said the same sort of thing where he said, look, I hung out with the chart guys and everything they worked on was on a perfectly flat, perfectly straight you know, these courses. And he goes, nobody adjusted for anything. And nope. you combine that with the stuff that he would see, which was one of my follow-up questions too, which was, okay, so you're a captain and you're in open water off of Florida, you know, lots of open expanse in the Atlantic. You know, you're seeing nothing but flat horizons, obviously, because it's water in all directions.
Yeah.
Did you ever, kind of like the pilots that I talked to, the pilots would say, well, the horizon looks flat, but it can't actually be flat. Did you ever get any creepy moment where you're looking and it's like, you know, did you ever have a doubt when you were out there? Or was it just, you know, something, you know, you were so conditioned that you never even questioned it for a second?
No, I didn't question it. And maybe being down at the water level is less than it being up in the air for that amount of time. Now in hindsight, like the whole lighthouse thing comes up. And one place I worked a majority of my career, actually, there was an unlit lighthouse that was built by someone that owned the island, and they put it on the wrong side of the waterway. So the Coast Guard didn't know. It's a gorgeous lighthouse, but it can't be lit. They lit it one time, and it got shut down. I used to use that as a visual navigational aid, because you don't always want to get out your Jeep. You know, you're leaving, you know, before the sun in the morning with your divers, and you don't need to have all your stuff when you do the same thing over and over. So yeah. I would use this lighthouse as a navigational aid, just because I could see it over there. And going back now and doing 8 inches per mile squared properly, that lighthouse from my port would have just been over the curvature from my port. In other words, I shouldn't have been able to see it. Well, not only could, you know, because everybody's like, oh, that bottom little bit gets fuzzy. Well, not only on a good day could I see the lighthouse, I could see the shoreline of the island that it was on. So, because there was a little bit of sand in a couple of spots, and then the seawall right under it, I could actually see the highlights of that from my port all the way across the – it's Biscayne Bay, which is part of the Atlantic Ocean, but it's partially enclosed by islands.
Every one of these experts should have considered the curvature of the Earth and or axial rotation in their work. But all of them affirmed that the globe model is false. How can that be? Even if we assume that refraction somehow tricks us into believing the world is flat based on optical measurements by arcing images perfectly over the ball, which truly belies common sense, are there now other non-optical physics that have tricked all of these experts as well? Think about this. What tricks the surveyors into not considering curvature, as curvature adjustments would necessarily be physical, not just optical, that would have to be accounted for on paper and construction projects? What new physics enable practicing surveyors and engineers to ignore the curvature of the Earth? It can't be refraction. It can't be gravity. What about the pilots and the submarine captain? Does this unproven gravity act as a supernatural leveling device for both airplanes and submarines? Don't you see that the farce of gravitational attraction could never do such a thing? Does gravity also somehow level gyroscopes, even though mainstream science claims that gyroscopes can measure curvature and axial rotation? Gyroscopes are designed and understood to defy gravity, but then gravity still somehow causes the gyroscope to remain level with the ball no matter what? How could that be? How could the horizontal indicator in an airplane even work if gravity somehow keeps it level? It would be useless. What about the radar operators? Did refraction or gravity bend the radar signals beyond the curvature as well? What new physics does that? You can't call radar beams a mirage. What about the merchant marine who says that the nautical maps would have to be based on a flat earth map or there'd be errors causing boats to wreck? What physics makes all the maps work together without considering curvature adjustments? What physics causes the horizon to rise to eye level for pilots, even though the horizon line should recede quickly on a globe? Refraction cannot explain that reality. Don't you see the problem here? How many different types of physics would have to be involved with each of these different experts to create the so-called illusion of a flat world? Is nature hell-bent on coordinating even undiscovered physics to trick people into believing the world is flat? It's asinine when you really think about it. The globe is false. The Earth is flat and stationary. Accept the flat Earth truth or wallow in your ignorance and stifle your own personal progression. Now I urge everyone to watch the full interviews by clicking on the links in the description. Also subscribe. Join me next time for proof number 3.